Simon & Schuster Australia presents Ciao Bella, Six Take Italy, written and narrated by me, Kate Langbroek. For the Adventurers. Introduction. There's a lot of talk in this world about making dreams come true. Dare to dream, we're told. Chase your dreams. If you can dream it, you can do it. Well, in 2016, I had a dream. My dream, shared so fully and immediately with my husband, Peter Lewis, that neither of us can remember the moment we actually formulated it, was to live in Italy for a year. For us, it meant a circuit breaker, an adventure, a chance to spend more time with our four children, Lewis, Sunday, Artie and Yanni, in a country we'd been swept away by since our first visit in 2015. But all dreams dissolve in waking hours, and when uttered aloud in the stark light of day, suddenly seem like madness. We didn't speak Italian. We knew no one in Italy. In fact, we'd only been in the country for a few weeks on rose-tinted Aperol spritz-toasting basil-scented holidays. My parents hated the idea. I also had the best job in the world, hosting a top-rating afternoon drive radio show with my friend and colleague of 18 years, Dave Hughes, in Australia, not in Italy. As for the children, by the time we planned to leave on our grand adventure, two of them, Lewis and Sunday, would be teenagers, reluctant to uproot their lives and leave all they knew. So what we swiftly discovered was this. The world doesn't necessarily share your dream. This is the story of an Australian family making their way across the world to a foreign land, trying to find an apartment, a car, a supermarket, a basketball team, a school, a cafe that would serve them a cappuccino after 11 a.m, no milk after morning, and hopefully their place in a foreign place. And it is also the story of our 16-year-old son, Lewis Lewis, the boy who lived. The boy who at six was diagnosed with childhood leukemia and survived, and who, because of this, was the unwitting motivation behind our bold move. The deep irony is that though we wanted to seize life because he nearly lost his, he would rather not be in Italy. It is about the day-to-day of Italian life, trying to learn a new language and make new friends, and what you discover about yourself when you're a stranger in a strange land. It's about stepping up and falling down on cobblestones. It is about the Australian spirit, about wearing thongs as footwear and leaving the swimming pool with wet hair and laughing when many would weep. It is about fear and courage, about having a dream and living it. Mostly, it is about love. Part 1. 1. Italia. Falling in love. It is no great revelation that certain countries or cities can become shorthand for a feeling, that their very name becomes one with an ethos or experience. Hawaii, Thailand, New York. The name of the place automatically conjures a mental picture, so much so that when you say you're going there, others will immediately intuit what sort of holiday or experience you will have. Hawaii, for instance, is cocktails in tiki bars and old dudes doing the shaka, surfing on longboards, garlands of leis, Elvis Presley movies, volcanic rock and swimming with giant turtles. In Thailand, you will float in aquamarine waters, eat green curry, drink fresh mango juice, tuk-tuk to markets and marvel at strange foods and maybe wash an elephant in a village stream. New York is the subway and musicals and eccentricity on the streets. It is the Met and Empire State of Mind and Sex in the City, hopefully not the lamentable second movie, in a glittering, tumbling urban front-loader. Of course, this is not necessarily the case. You could be in any of these places working as a nurse or a builder covered in limestone and dust. You may be a free-running, teetotaling Instafluencer who consumes their surrounds for likes. You may spend the day in a funk, weeping in your fourth-floor red brick freeway-facing apartment. Just as we don't know the inner workings of each other's lives, so it is with a foreign country. We have no idea of the way in which it will open up to us and us to it, and yet we think we do. Few places on earth, it seems, conjure up more of an emotional response than Italy. It is a land that transcends cliché by simply piling on more of them. Afternoon slumbers and wine, church bells and saints, terracotta-coloured villas and washing hanging over balconies, grapevines and pasta and glittering seas and venerated old people. It is cobbled thoroughfares and picture book villages, Pinocchio and families in the piazza, sliced meats and summer fruits and music on the streets and romance. It is golden light caressing not just the ancient stone buildings upon which it alights, but also those blessed to bask in its rays. Falling in love with a country is like falling in love with a person. You are initially tentative. You start off with a few dates, with a country drive, with dinner. If that goes well, you return for more. Magical outings in which it feels everything is brushed with possibility. Suddenly your heart is singing. You've never looked better. You feel alive, like your true unfettered self. You are open and happy and free. You laugh. You see things differently. Mostly, falling in love is not so much about the reality of the other person as it is about how they make you feel about yourself. I wasn't looking to fall in love with Italy. I wasn't expecting it. It just happened. There were seminal moments that made me fall in love. Many were as fleeting as feelings. Sometimes, tellingly, they emerged from chaos. In Milan, we were driving along a narrow street jammed with parked cars on either side. I was looking down from my perch in our idling van into the pit of an adjacent building site. Instead of construction vehicles busying themselves, I saw an archaeological dig. A few muted worker bees were sectioning portions of dry earth or brushing off pieces of broken pottery meticulously laid out alongside their roped-off dig. The scene was, we were to discover, a not uncommon occurrence in this old, old country where the earth, when it is moved, will often reveal the past. To us, it was fascinating. So mesmerising that it actually took a while to realise our progress had been halted. We were alerted to our inertia when the drivers around us, impatient with being patient, started leaning on their horns and yelling. One of the children hopped out of the back seat to scout the thoroughfare and see what was causing the hold-up. Their report, breathlessly delivered on their return, was so remarkable we all had to lean out the windows to confirm it for ourselves. Ahead of us, a delivery van had stopped right in the middle of the street. The driver had left his vehicle and was standing on the narrow footpath at the corner of a cafe. There he was, casually downing a shot of espresso. The exasperated tooting and catcalls from the other drivers reached a cacophony before he deigned to acknowledge them. His coffee finished, he twirled his arm in an unflustered, "Yes, yes," motion, returned to his van, got behind the wheel again, and we all moved off. Near Siena, we were searching for our hillside accommodation in a tiny village intersected rather cruelly some years back by a freeway. The town, once an armoury, was called Armeolo and was now a relative ghost town, bakery shuttered and the only restaurant seeming permanently closed. We were looking for an agriturismo, farmstay accommodation, we had booked several weeks prior. We had been misled, as so often happens in Italy, by Google Maps, and ended up on a narrow dirt road flanked by tiny plots of farmed land. In the absence of any street numbers and very few houses, we pulled up in front of some old wrought iron gates, behind which was a two-story, slightly crumbly, dusty rose villa. It seemed like the place, but when we rang the bell, no one answered. Weary of being car-bound, the kids scrambled out and found a track leading up to the hill alongside the house. We followed them and suddenly popped out through the bushes to a scene straight from a European film. There, surrounded by a sparse orchard of olive and stone fruit trees, was a glittering blue swimming pool. Perched on the stone edging, her legs trailing in the water, was a mahogany-skinned goddess in a scrap of a bikini. Lying alongside her, his head cradled on her lap, was an equally bronzed Adonis. He was staring up at her as she stroked his hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.